This thing's looking kind of wild. This apple tree needs attention so bad, just so freaking bad, but there's nothing I can do about it. I have to actually change my plans. Hey there, where have you been? Chasing everything on our property. It's morning and we have a thunderstorm rolling and there's some lightning on the distance. And I had plans because somebody, I don't remember what his name, he mentioned, well actually there's more than one, but somebody asked me in detail about pruning apple trees and why I did what I did and how I did and if I could do a follow-up. And I like to do follow-ups and I will be doing follow-ups on this, but I can't do it right now. I'm going to have to postpone this for an indefinite period of time because I had a medical emergency come up. And so I wanted to explain it to you in case you were wondering why I'm acting the way I am sometimes. About a month ago, I went to bed and I was perfectly fine. And then I woke up the next morning and I could only lift my arm up about this much. And I didn't know, well, I could lift it farther, but it hurt like heck. It hurt like the dickens. And I couldn't figure out why it would hurt. I mean, I can do this perfectly fine, but I can only go up about this far before it just has this shooting pain going through my arm. And I didn't know what it was. I figured, well, I haven't done anything really strenuous. I don't know why it would happen overnight. You know, what kind of a weird dream did I have? So I took care of it. I took a leave and I kind of pampered my arm and I didn't lift it up that much. And I waited a couple weeks and it didn't go away. So I went to my doctor and he took x-rays, all kinds of x-rays. And he moved the arm around and he heard some crunching sound going on in here. So he sent me to a specialist. The only problem is I couldn't see the specialist for 2 weeks. So for 2 weeks, I'm walking around kind of like a wingless bird. And the specialist checked my arm out. And he said that there is something wrong with a rotator cuff. And that's some kind of weird apparatus your arm has over here. Not cup, cuff. And it's tendons and muscles and stuff. And what he thinks is there's bone spurs and there's pre-arthritic conditions happening over here. And it's swelling and there's an impingement. I know this is really kind of complicated and it has nothing to do with gardening, but it has to do with me and I have to do with gardening because I can't do what I want to do. And so he stuck a needle and he said, I'm going to give you a cortisone shot. And I said, hey, I can do a shot, no problem at all. Thing he didn't tell me is that I should have known, but how am I supposed to know? I've never had this before. The thing about a cortisone shot is it's not just a shot. You know, he doesn't just go and give you a little shot. Oh, no, 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 no. He takes a needle, this long needle, and he pushes it in. And it just keeps going and going and going until it hits through the muscle into the material in there. It's this long, drawn out, incredibly painful shot. And I'm trying to be a man about this and go, oh, it doesn't hurt. And then finally, I just couldn't help it. I go, hey, this hurts. He goes, well, I guess it does. I thought, you could have warned me before because I don't want to move and have a needle snap off my arm. But he gave me a shot. He prescribed physical therapy. So I'm seeing a physical therapist and I have to go see him in another month. But until then, I can't be raising my arm up very far. And I do sometimes because I forget. And I do, and then later on, it just hurts like heck. It swells up and then I pay the price. And I was supposed to, this brings me back to what I was gonna tell you. I was supposed to prune this apple tree because it needs it. It has these, you know, suckers going up and I need to get those things off of there before they get too awfully established because they're taking some of the energy I want to flow down to the apples because the apples are starting to get bigger now. Yeah, they're looking pretty good. But what I've been doing, as much as I can reach up with my left arm, my one good arm, what I'm doing is I'm going through these as much as I possibly can. You can see how some of them have two, but generally they come in clusters of three or more. See? And what I'm doing is I'm trying to reach up here and I'm just gently pulling off the excess. And this one was the smallest of the cluster and I want to get rid of this. So what I'm doing is I'm taking this and smashing it and feeding it to the chickens. Nothing goes to waste here. And this gives these a little bit more room to grow up because when these are full-size apples, these are Honeycrisp, these are decent-sized apples. Four of them on this little spur here would crowd each other out with those short stems. And what they do is they push out some of them and they just snap off because there's just not enough room to expand. You see what I'm talking about? And that wastes apples. Better to get rid of the lesser of all of them, the weakest of all of them, to give them a little bit more room to expand. Because more is definitely not always better when it comes to your garden. So if you're looking at your fruit trees and you see like clusters of them, you know it's going to be a problem when they get older. Look for any damaged ones, look for any smaller ones, because that's only going to get worse. And get rid of those weaker ones. Throw them in your compost pile, feed them to your chickens. Eat them if you want to. But I have to get rid of a lot of these. And I really do have to prune this. Let me focus up at the top for you. Okay, up here is the cluster I was just showing. And they're all over the tree, but way up there, see those tall vertical ones? Yeah, those ones I call suckers. People call them water sprouts. They go by a million different names. You can just call them branches because that's just all they are. Now those ones I need to get rid of because I don't want my tree getting any taller. I want it to grow out and grow strong. I want it to grow laterally. And that's why I'm encouraging branches that come out and put out the fruit over here. I don't want fruit way up there because it's harder for me to reach, and it's also attracting birds. When that fruit turns red, it's like a signal to those birds, and the winds are stronger up there. Those branches are going to wave back and forth if they ever have fruit on them, like in the following years, and that's not a good thing. I like my branches to be down lower where they're less likely to be waving around and losing fruit. Hey there! How you doing? Whoop. Good morning. Did you find anything interesting? Whoops. He's on his way. It's morning time. He's got to spend his time patrolling the property, making sure everything's okay. There's nothing out of place. He totally owns the place. But if you look down at a rascal eye view of this lawn, and I've let it grow a little bit. During the summer, I like to let it grow a little bit longer because it helps hold the moisture a little bit better than a low-cut lawn. But look down here. Tell me what you see. A lot of flowers, aren't there? And these are clover flowers. These are white clover. And white clover puts out a beautiful clover smell. And they grow fast and they flower profusely. Let me get up here and look. As far as you can see, look at that. Is that something? It's just filled with clover. And I can do a panoramic view, and that's what you're going to see. Early spring, it's dandelions. Midsummer, it's clover, and the grass is in between. But this clover, it not only puts out a beautiful smell, it's also serving a function. My yard is actually working for me. Hey, how you doing? I gotta watch my step. I actually need some stairs coming down here. I think that'll make it a lot easier on me. Rascal just flies down here, but then again, his legs are only 2 inches long. This right here, right next to my Frady hole, my cellar, this has been growing for a couple years. It keeps coming back every single year, and I wanted to show you this because I'm kind of proud of it. And it's something that a lot of people wouldn't even stand to have in their yard. But I encourage things like this because my thing about diversity helping my garden, and it's all about my garden as far as I'm concerned. And what is there, a mouse in my lawnmower? He's everywhere! Anyway, I'm talking about diversity in the garden, and this really does help. This is called a thistle. Take a close-up look at this and tell me what you think. This little booger is about 12 inches tall. This is called a thistle plant. Yeah, it has a particular name. I don't know what it is, but it's just what I call thistle. They have these spiny leaves that look a lot like holly. And yeah, you don't want to be touching these things. They are definitely a sticker type plant. But look over here. I don't just grow normal thistle. No. This is raised thistle. This is one plant, by the way. Way down inside of it was this little short plant, and I pruned off the top of it. You know, I do this to everything. I'm lopping heads off of everything around here. It's because I enjoy testing out new things, and I want to see how different plants respond to it. Well, this plant is taller than I am. It's around maybe 6 feet tall already, and it has multiple stems with flowers on the ends of each one of them. And let me swing over to the right so you can see these other ones. Yeah, these are flowers. This is thistle, folks. And thistle is if you've ever seen artichokes in the store or restaurants or eaten them or grown them, artichokes are a member of the thistle family. So this is closely related to artichokes. This is a flower that comes out, and it's not quite open yet, so it really doesn't have any smell. But it has pokey petals on it. And then after the flower starts blooming, let me back up here. This is a thistle flower in full bloom. And if you stick your nose up to it, don't be afraid. The purple part is really soft. It's very, very soft. And it has a beautiful fragrance to it. These will draw bees from miles around and all other kinds of insects. But what I've noticed is bees love thistle. And it draws them like a magnet. And that's what this does. This is like a beacon for all of these bees to come into the yard. This is early morning. The bees aren't out yet. But once they come out, these will be buzzing in bees. And I encourage that. I love this. This is a thistle, and this is a plant that most people wouldn't want. They dig it out by the roots. But the thing is that it's not hurting anybody, and it's helping my garden. That's what I'm trying to get at here, is that nature can actually work with you. You don't have to fight every minute of every day to fight nature. You can actually use it a little bit to your advantage, and you can all live together. Look at my roof. Yeah, I got to change the roof on this thing. But let's focus on the plants for right now. This is a thistle. Today, oh, see, look what we got here. Hey, it's breakfast. Yeah, you don't like this. Let me wipe this off. Morning strawberry. Yeah, I just graze. That's got to go to the chicken. I should have gave that to the chicken. This is my strawberry bed. This is the upper garden. I call this the upper garden. And then I have the lower garden down there. But back to what I was talking about, diversity in the garden, is between my rows, I have weeds. Yeah, I have weeds between here. Not a whole lot of grass. I have thistle. I have clover. I have dandelions. I have all kinds of stuff that probably makes a lot of gardeners cringe. And that's okay. But this isn't their garden, this is my garden. And this is the way that I do things. Somebody mentioned, I think it was yesterday, I was seeing it in the comments, they said, Ray, you need to weed your garden. And I thought about it and I thought, yeah, I actually do. But this isn't the part that I'm gonna weed. I just keep this mowed down so that I can walk through it. But what this does is this is like a wildlife habitat. And my way of thinking is that when you're gardening, if you have a monoculture growing just one type of plant, like say for instance carrots, okay, if you're growing carrots and you have nothing else growing around there, and there's going to be insects, let's face it, you live on this planet and insects are everywhere. What they're going to do is they're looking for food. That's all they're looking for. They don't understand that this is off limits. They're going to come looking for food. And if all they see is carrots, that's what they're going to try and eat, is carrots. Now, I have all of this over here. And I see a lot of bugs walking around and doing their thing, and that's fine with me. They're hanging out over here, and these kind of get lost in the shuffle. And I have very few problems with pests. And that's why you don't really hear me talking about aphids and slugs and things like that, because the methods that I use, I generally don't have that issue. Now, let me address a couple issues so I can give you a couple tips, okay? This is something that I think might help you in your garden in the future, if it's not helping you right now. Okay, slugs. Slugs and snails are a big deal, and people have problems with those. They fight them, and they just can't seem to figure out how to get rid of slugs and snails. And I get asked quite a bit, Ray, how do you get rid of slugs and snails? And my first response is, I don't have slugs and snail problems. I just don't. And the reason is that, for one thing, I encourage birds. You can hear them? Hear them in here? I encourage birds. And that's by feeding my chickens and turkeys out in the yard. And it attracts birds to come down and get feed. And I also have the water bowl. There's a cardinal over there right now. I wish I could just swivel this over. They come over and they drink out of the water bowl. So this is a habitat for wild birds. And birds love slugs and snails. A robin will wipe out so many slugs and snails in your garden. But the thing is you got to get them there. And another way to get rid of slugs and snails is keep your soil dry. Think about what a slug or a snail is. It's nothing but a walking, talking ball of slime, okay? And it's got to generate moisture in order to travel on that layer of slime. Now, if you water your garden all the time, like you're using a soaker hose and you're slowly giving it water all the time, what are you doing there? You're giving those slugs and snails a reason to be there, and you're giving them a superhighway. They have moisture that they can travel on, and that's what they love. They love moisture. If you have a lot of weeds in your garden, that's going to make it more conducive to slugs and snails, because, hey, that's a mosquito. That's not good. Okay, that's the one piece of nature I can do without is mosquitoes. But anyway, when you have a lot of weeds in your garden, what that's going to do is that's going to keep the ground a little bit moist for your plants. And that may be a good thing for your plants. But on the downside of that, that all those weeds and stuff are going to lock in humidity and moisture. And what's that going to do? That's going to be a breeding ground and a super highway for those slugs to just go all over the place, and they can decimate your plants. What I do, for instance, in my strawberries, I've been pulling weeds like mad. I keep the weeds down and I give them a good soaking first thing in the morning. Now here's a tip for you. Water your plants first thing in the morning. And what that's going to do is, I know that a lot of you work, but if you possibly can, water them in the morning, and that way they have all day to use this moisture. Slugs don't come out quite as much during the hot of the day. They like to stay hidden and come out at night. So those of you who water your garden in the evening, you're going to have a little bit more problem, because you have nighttime, which is the time for slugs to come out, because they're not stupid. They know that predators aren't out as much at night. They're going to come out at night. It's cooler. It's moist in your garden. It's a total feeding frenzy, and you wake up in the morning and you got holes all over your plants. Water them in the morning. That way in the evening the soil has had time to dry out. Not as much of an environment for slugs. Keep those weeds down. That way you have dry, crusty soil in the evening, and that's not good for slugs, because they have to generate moisture to walk on. And if they're walking on a desert, it's basically sucking the moisture out of their body. It's not something that they want to do, okay? And since I have weeds and everything here that keeps it moist over here, the slugs and snails are more likely to be in this area than in this area here. See what I'm talking about? So it's not a matter of fighting nature tooth and nail and getting a blowtorch. It's a matter of trying to understand what's going on and try to have it work with you with the clover. This is something that some people may not want in their yard, a whole bunch of weeds and stuff. But those weeds, like I showed you the clover, I showed you that for a reason. The clover and the thistle, and I have other weeds here. What that does is it draws in pollinating insects. People are asking me, Ray, how do I pollinate my plants? That's another thing. I'm going over as much as I possibly can, because I want to help you as much as I possibly can. Pollination right about now. Folks are having problems with their peppers not producing because they're not getting pollinated. Their squash, other kinds of flowers that are on their plants not getting pollinated. The thing is that you want to bring in your pollinators. So you use your yard to your advantage. Promote a few dandelions here and there. They're not going to kill you. Yeah, people think that they may be ugly, but come on, when we were kids, we loved dandelions. Keep that in your mind, okay? They're not a harmful thing. Dandelions bring up nutrients from way down low, and then when they die, they deposit them on the surface. That helps your lawn grow. This is actually helping to feed your lawn. A viewer asked me, Ray, what do you feed your lawn? And I thought, nothing. I don't feed my lawn. My lawn feeds itself. It's a self-perpetuating thing. And you may think that lawns, you know, it's a common way of thinking that lawns cannot continue unless you add food, because they just can't supply themselves with enough food. Well, if you let weeds grow in there, I'm not saying have it all weeds, but allow some of them to grow in there. The dandelions are going to help. The clover is going to help. And they also bring in pollinators, and those pollinators will pollinate your lawn, but they'll also come to your garden. And that's where it's going to really come in handy. It's going to pollinate your plants, and it's going to help you get a little bit better of a harvest than just having, like, say, a monoculture and, you know, the heck with nature. Because what we're doing here is we're trying to work with nature, because if you fight it, you're going to lose, okay? And mainstream gardening is not set to help you win with nature. It's designed to actually hurt nature, because you got pesticides, you got herbicides, you got artificial fertilizers. That's mainstream gardening. We're talking organic gardening here. In organic gardening, you have to have a little give and take, okay? This is a compromise situation. So you're going to have a few weeds. That's going to have to be okay with you. If not, you might as well just close up this window and go to your local ortho dealer and get yourself some diazinon, some liquid 7, some Roundup, and some Miracle-Gro, because that's what you're going to need. If you're working with organics, you're going to make compost, you're going to buy compost, you're going to encourage certain kind of plants to bring in pollinators, sunflowers, marigolds, all kinds of stuff. And it's going to help your garden grow better. My garden has a few pests that come in, but then again, they don't really bother me that much. That's why I don't have specific sections talking about how to get rid of all of these nasty things. Aphids, I don't really have a problem with aphids. Outside the garden, I have a lot of aphids. I think I showed this in a picture on Facebook. One of those plants way up on the hill over here was just covered in aphids. The cool thing is, I didn't have any aphids down here. Healthy plants can withstand aphid attacks a lot better than unhealthy plants. So if you water, keep them watered in the morning, let them dry out in the evening, keep them fed with compost in your soil. That's going to be a healthy plant. Aphids tend to attack weak plants, and so there are ways to get rid of aphids. You can mix like half rubbing alcohol, half water. That's a quick, easy way to get rid of aphids. Just mix it in a spray bottle, mist your plant top to bottom in the evening after the sun's off of it. It's a quick, instant kill. It may not be the most organic thing, because people argue that, you know, rubbing alcohol isn't organic, but you know what? I don't do everything 100% organic. I do what I can. I do the best I can with what I have to work with. So sometimes, I mean, it's not organic to be using a shovel. I mean, that's man-made. So we make compromises here and there. And so when I spray, When I spray a little bit of rubbing alcohol on some insects, I'm okay with that, because it's not going to leave a residual. And Rascal is probably going to walk in my lettuce again. But what can you do? Anyway, I wanted to bring that to your attention, because that's what I do with my gardening, and hopefully that'll help you. When it comes to pests and stuff, there are ways to work around things without going all bat crazy on it, all right? So when it comes to pollinating, go to your tomatoes, tap them. That's how you pollinate a tomato. You don't need to worry about pollinating insects. Most tomatoes, all you got to do, tap them. The wind hits them, moves them around. That's how they get pollinated. That's how their flowers work. With peppers, tickle their flowers if you want to make sure they're pollinated. That's one way to pollinate them. Other plants, I guess you'd have to ask me a question on that, because all plants are a little bit different. Anyway, that's my episode today. It's not going to be a pruning episode, because Ray is a one-armed bandit today, but I wanted to help you as much as I possibly can with what I have to work with, and I only have one good arm here. But thank you, everybody, for joining me in the garden on this morning, and I think we got about a half an hour before rain hits, so I got to get out of here. Thank you for joining me. I really do appreciate it. If you have any questions about your garden, post it in the comment section below. I'll do my very best to give you the very best answer I possibly can. Okay. Hi. Your nose is filthy. You little piglet. You're my organic mouse control. Yes, you are. Thanks, everybody, again, and have a great day. Okay. You, me. Let's go do something. Crackhead.